أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Alhamdulillah, we start by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we send our salam and salawat on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're doing our journey, the short journey of the smaller and shorter surahs of the Quran because of this holiday period. Inshallah ta'ala, probably from the next week or the week after, we'll go back to our regular journey through Quran where we finish Surah Al-Anfal. So we'll start from Surah Al-Tawbah from next week. So in this holiday period, in the last few weeks, we did the shorter surah like Surah Al-Bayyina, Surah Al-Zilzal, Surah Al-Adiyat, you know, which did Surah Al-Asr, Surah Al-Humaza, and also had a quick summary last week about the 10 surahs, the last 10 surahs of the Quran. So today I have a special lecture, which is again obviously from the Quran, the last ayah of the Quran. So imagine the gravity of this topic, of this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided us with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam through his guidance, Al-Quran. And we all know the story how the Quran began. It began with Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, when our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only 40 years old, and in that age, you know, he was in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses him to be the Prophet and the Rasul. Not only that, he chooses him to the leader of all the Prophets and Rasul, and the last Prophet for the whole mankind. The last Prophet for the whole mankind, and also for the jinn and for everything. So he was the last Prophet. And obviously, as you all know, that Quran is the last wahi that has come to us, and nothing will come after this one. So in these 40 years, when its journey started from the age of the 40 years of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam till he dies since year 63, in these 23 years of time, at different time, different ayahs came down to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as you all know, that, you know, according to the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the angel Jibreel alayhi salam, that, you know, Rasulullah put the surahs in get together. He knows which ayah to go with surah. Some of the narration sometimes suggests that during one time, even like, you know, with the spam of 1 week, that he had different ayahs from different surahs. So, you know, there are a few ayahs probably from Surah Al-Baqarah, few ayahs from Ali Imran, few ayahs from the Surah Al-Hajj or something, and he is the one who is in charge to put them on organized, okay? And this is the strongest opinion, that even the organization of the surah, because there is another opinion that says the sahaba are the one who arranged the surah, but that's a weaker opinion. Because as you know from the other hadith, that Prophet ﷺ, the last Ramadan that he had in his life, he revised the Quran twice with Jibreel alayhi salam. And he always used to start the Quran after Fatiha, then Baqarah, Surah Ali Imran. That way, the Quran is preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us. So this is the way it was organized. So among all these things, imagine the last ayah that will come to the Quran. So the last thing Allah is telling to the humankind before the day of judgment. This is the last communication between Allah and all the humanity through his wahi al-Quran with Jibreel alayhi salam. Obviously, you should understand, you know, what will be that ayah, what will be the last message. You know, when a sheikh or someone, you know, we're not comparing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the comparison of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But, you know, just to understand, you know, when someone give a lecture or if someone writes a book or something, the last para or the last few lines are the conclusion. You know, something that will carry the value, the summary of all the things. So let's look at what did Allah say for the last time to the human being through Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now there are three opinions that which ayah is the last ayah of the Quran. Okay, it is not the last surah we are talking about, because Surah An-Nas, you know, as we know, this is the last thing that is came in Makkah long time ago, even before Rasulullah, you know, went to Medina. Okay, and some opinions say he was in Medina, the early Medinan time, but this is a shorter surah. But I'm talking about the last ayah of the Quran. Nothing came after this one. So there are three opinions actually, but there are three ayah that scholars suggested. The strongest opinion of them is the ayah that I'm going to present today. One ayah from Surah Al-Baqarah is ayah number 281. The other ayah that the meaning is like, you know, more, you know, relevant, that, you know, it looks like this could be the last ayah, where in Surah Al-Maidah in ayah number 3, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that today is the day I have completed your deen Islam. Okay, I have made it, you know, I have made haram any other deen. It is the your deen, that Islam. That is another opinion. And there's another ayah of Surah Al-Tawbah actually, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, you know, I have sent among you a prophet So follow him and, you know, obey him. So some of the scholars say that is the another ayah. But the stronger opinion and the majority of scholars say this is the ayah that I'm going to present today. Then this is the last ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed for the Quran, and this is towards the end of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The ayah is very, very short ayah, but the words and the meanings are very meaningful, and you know, it carries a value. So inshallah, look at this and you can memorize this ayah, as it is a very, very small, shorter ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 281. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجِعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ تُعَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُزْلَمُونَ. Okay, so the meaning of the ayah, as you can see in the English, which is very similar to the Arabic translation, but we're just going to go a little bit deeper and try to explain a few of the words from the ayah. So Allah is saying, fear a day. Yawman, as you all know, Yawman means day. A day, which day? A day when everybody will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is talking about the judgment day. Okay, and then he said that every soul, kullu nafsin, every soul will be compensated, will be given. You know, wafa means to give something. Okay, so Allah will compensate every soul what they have earned, where in this world, and no one will be treated unjustly. Wahum la yuzlamun. And some of the scholar in explaining this ayah, they explain the whole ayah and then come to the last word, yuzlamun. Yuzlamun means, you know, it's come from zalimun or zalim, you know, as you told, even in our language, in Bangladeshi language, in Bangla language, in Hindi language, in Urdu, this word zalim is always there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used this word so many times in so many ayah. That, you know, inna Allah la yuhibbul zalimun, Allah doesn't love the zalimun, okay? You know, don't go, you know, beyond your, don't transgress and you will be among the zalimun, okay? So even that word, the last word that came into the Quran, according to the lost of the scholar, they explained this, or, you know, they put treaties about the word zalimun. There's so many hadiths about why Allah used the last word. Allah could have said al-muttaqeen or a lot of other things, but Allah talked about zalimun. We'll talk about it a little bit later, inshallah ta'ala. So let's begin from the top. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, wattaku. So wattaku, as you all know, that word taqwa. You know, we have heard so many lessons about taqwa, and obviously the word taqwa, we all know what does it mean. The real meaning of taqwa is to protect yourself. To protect yourself, so you know there is some harm in front of you and you're taking some action. So it's not only knowing that you have harm. So if I say there is a danger outside of this door, so you have the knowledge that, okay, if I go out, could be something wrong. You know, there could be some fire or some, you know, someone is waiting there to, you know, do some harm for you. And you take action for that. According to that knowledge, you say, no, then I'm not going to go through this door. I have to take this door out. Or I have to wait for some hour if someone comes and tell me. So you have some precaution and action. That is called taqwa. That is called muttaqi. As you all know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started the Quran, you know, alif lam mim zalikal kitabu la rayba fi hudal lil muttaqin. This whole book, Al-Quran, is only for the guidance for muttaqins. Okay? And the same thing Allah is saying, the wattaku, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't mean only fear. You know, fear has a lot of other meanings. Fear means, you know, you're scared of something, you know, scared of snake or something. There's a different kind of fear. But the real meaning of taqwa is that you are scared of displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Islamic point of view, and also you're taking some action to protect yourself. And that's why Allah said just after taqwa, yawman. So protect yourself, make yourself prepare that from that day when everybody will return. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used turja'una. Turja'una means that, you know, everybody will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as they came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, that's why when some people die, what do we say? We say inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. You know, that's the same thing, turja'un, the same word, you know, inshallah, when you learn more Arabic, you'll know that's the same root word, same verb, okay? So Allah is saying, everybody will come to me. So have taqwa of that day. And then Allah also mentioned his own name, fihi ilallah, that, you know, everybody will come to whom? Everybody come to with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even his name, his word, Allah mentioned it and included it in the last ayah that, you know, yes, everybody will be coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah is saying, summa tuwaffa kullu nafsin. And as I mentioned before, tuwaffa means that, you know, it's something that you have done before, you have done a hard work, and now you are waiting to get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Or reward from your boss, your owner, that you did something for them. And you're waiting for that. You're eagerly waiting for that. And that is the word tuwaffa. that, you know, Allah saying that Allah will compensate. And Allah didn't say that I will compensate only Muslim. Allah said kullu nafsin. As you all know that the Arabic word kullu means all, you know, it means everything. And nafsin here means every soul. So it doesn't matter he is a Muslim, he is a Christian, or whatever he is, which prophet he came up, nor any living thing, any nafs that Allah has created, everybody will be on that day, will be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what will be the rewarded for? Kullu nafsin ma kasabat. You know, the word kasabat here also, we find this word toward the end of Surah Al-Baqarah also, where with the famous ayah, you know, lillahi ma fi samawati wa ard, you know, wa yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa usaha laha ma kasabat wa alayha ma iktasabat. Whoever does what, your deed is only, you are responsible for your deed. Okay? Yes, there are other things that, you know, in the world, you are in charge of something. If you are in charge, you know, everybody is in charge of their family, you know, their household. So if you have the authority of the household, so you are in charge of that. But rather, that's your responsibility. And even each responsibility that you do, only you will be asked. Allah wants, you cannot give Allah excuse. Oh Allah, I used to live in that city and everybody was doing this. That's why I did it. There's no excuses like this. That's why Allah said, you earned your things. You earned your reward. You earned your bad deeds or good deeds. It's all your own responsibility. And then Allah said, وَهُمْ لَا يُزْلَمُونَ. That nobody will be unjustly treated. On the judgment day, you know, two things will happen. Okay, there will be no injustice. Obviously, why? Because Allah is never ever unjust. It's not that Allah cannot be unjust. Allah can unjust if you wish. But His rahmah, His mercy is so much, He never ever unjust. So only two things that happen in judgment day. The one thing that He will be just. So wherever it's necessary, He will be just. So people will get what they have done. Or Allah will have mercy on the people. Just like us, you know, the people who are believers, who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our deeds are not enough to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The status of Allah, you know, we can never reach that status with our ibadah. We cannot never deserve that point. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on us, and that's why we'll be able to get the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And zalimun, the word zalimun, it comes from the root word, you know, zulumat actually. And the word itself has a meaning of darkness. And in one of the hadith, Prophet ﷺ said, you know, on the day of judgment, there will be zulumat, meaning for the disbeliever, there will be layers of darkness after darkness. They won't have any light. So you know, that is the meaning, one of the meaning of the zulm. And the other common meaning that we understand, that if someone is torturing somebody, that he is a zulm. He's doing zulm on the other people. But actually in the Quran, Allah not always use the word same way. Like Allah said, Pharaoh is a zalim because he used to torture his people, okay? He used to torture the slaves of Bani Israel, okay? That one kind of zulm. But if you read through the Quran properly, you know, the story of Adam alayhi salam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and put him and his wife into the Jannah, he told them that everything for your enjoyment. But, you know, لا تقرب هذه الشجرة, meaning don't go near to that tree. If you go there, you will be min az-zalimin. You will be among the wrongdoers. So how can Adam do zulm in that time? Because there is only Adam and his wife. There's no other people to torture. So Allah, why Allah is saying that, you know, he's going to be zulm? Because, you know, he is not following the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and from that point, the scholar said, you know, if you do any sin, if you disobey instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be considered as a zalimun, as a zalim. Why is so? Because you are doing zulm on your nafs, your own self. Because your own fitrah is supposed to follow the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you take yourself away from the fitrah, your own fitrah, that is one kind of zulm that you are doing. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that, you know, on that day, no zulm will happen. No injustice will happen. Okay, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in other places, the people who do zulm, and one of the meaning of the zulm, as I mentioned, you know, to replace the rights of others. So you know that this thing is supposed to be here, but you took it from here and put it other way. And that replacement is also called zulumat, you know, because it means that, you know, you're not being fair. In our simple language, it's not being fair. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, on that day, you know, there will be no injustice. And that's why when the kuffar, the people disbeliever, they will see that, you know, even the animals, Allah will brought them in the day of judgment. And if one animal with the horn has harmed another animal in this world, Allah will give the other one a pair of horn. And Allah will ask them, put the same thing that he did it into the to you in the world, and they will do it. And after they do this one, and once they are balanced, all the animals will be turned into dust. And this scene, this whole thing will be seen by the disbeliever. And they will understand if an animal with a simple poke of a horn has been balanced now, has been just now with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's going to happen with us? And that's why they will say, Kuntu turaba. Ya laitani kuntu turaba. They will say, oh Allah, we wish that we become dust, like this animal. We don't want to go through the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they know that each deed we do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala weigh each deed, and he will be just with all of us. So inshallah ta'ala, may Allah give us tawfiq to understand the value of this ayah. And I request everybody to memorize this ayah, to remember this ayah. Imagine that this is the last thing that Allah is telling us, that you have taqwa of that day when you return to him, and on that day you will get what you earn in this world. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to understand and follow the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Habib Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha ant, astaghfiruka, utubu ilayk.